Dad, I got the family glasses here. There was a pair laying back there.
All right.
Hang on, let me get you up here.
Happy New Year, everybody.
Happy New Year.
We few, we happy few, we band of brothers. Huh? And sisters.
You are good when there's nothing good in me. You are love on display for all to see. You are light when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all. You are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in you death has lost its sting.
Here we go!
And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running. God, of all else I'm letting go. And go, oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace, light of the world. My heart will sing, no other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name, Jesus, Jesus. And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace, light of the world forever reign.
Hey, greet one another with a happy new year on this January 1st Sunday. Hey, Chad, can you run my thing up? Yeah, run it up with some holy tape. Oh, I'm running to your arms. Just leave it there, Chad. I'll grab it in a second. Chorus, or I'm running to your arms. One.
And oh, I'm running to your arms. I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reign.
My heart will sing.
My heart will sing. No other name. Jesus. Jesus. My heart will sing. No other name. Jesus. Jesus. My heart will sing. No other name. Jesus. Jesus, my heart will sing, no other name. Jesus, Jesus. And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reign.
Ah, praise the Lord on this New Year Sunday. Lord, that is our, man, that is our prayer. That is our declaration. Forever reign, Lord, for your glory in our lives. And in all of creation. And Lord, as we bear witness to the reality of your presence, pour out your Holy Spirit, fill us afresh, that we might truly worship you in spirit and truth. Amen.
Amen.
Hey, take a seat. The big thing, tomorrow, 9:30-ish, we're going to reverse the Christmas decorations. So kind of an all hands on deck. If you can be here, and if you can help, can you guys help empty the platform like we did so we can get the ladders here, you know, move the drums and all that stuff off? Great. Also, no church tonight on a New Year's Day. So just know that. So stay warm and dry and all that. Anything else as we're potluck next Sunday? Are you asking me or telling me?
We got chicken.
Yes, I like potlucks. Chicken?
Chicken.
Chicken?
Chicken.
All right. Anything else? Thank you, Irene, for... Boy, it's weird having a first Sunday like this, isn't it? So early. Yeah. Yes, Karen. Did your house sell? Okay. Do you have a specific day, or is this kind of like a rolling thing? So you're hoping next weekend to get everything out? Saturday. Okay. All right. Okay, very good. Anything else? All right. Hey, the altar's open. I invite you to come, especially on this New Year's Day. We had a wonderful time, the Watch Night service, dedicating ourselves to the Lord in the renewed covenant. Really a tremendous time for all who showed up. Tremendous opportunity on the beginning of the new year. Man, to bow that knee and man, that absolute surrender, submission to the Lord, which makes miracles happen in our lives and all around the world. Praise the Lord. So come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful.
And kindle on us the fire of your love. One. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless and awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cause. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphans the sons and daughters? The King of glory, the King of glory, who shakes the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Worthy is the King that conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Worthy is the King that conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Worthy is the King that conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Worthy, worthy, with his amazing grace. This is a feeling love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, to lay down your life, that I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me. Yeah, praise God. Woo, Happy New Year. Amazing, isn't it? Praise God. I searched the world, but I couldn't feel.
Jerry, just
Ah. Trouble in the orchestra pit.
Hey, Chad.
Ready? One, two, one, two, three, four. I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long. Closer walk with thee.
Just a little bit closer.
Granted, Jesus, hear my plea.
Just a little bit closer.
Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. I got next.
Graves in the garden, brother.
Praise God. Well, I searched the world. Hang on. I'm going to start over. That's part of the problem. Trouble in the orchestra pit again. I got another one here. I'll be right with you. I am so, so sorry. I had the wrong music. Trouble in the orchestra pit again. I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise, treasures that fade, never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. Thank you, Lord. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing's better than you. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws, but you've seen it all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountains is the God of the valley. And there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing's better. There's nothing better than you, Lord. Nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing's better than you. You turn mourning to dancing. You turn shame into glory, and you're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens, you turn bones into armies, you turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, nothing better than you. Oh, Lord, nothing, nothing's better. There's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing better than you.
Hey, praise the Lord. Hey, since we are an intimate crowd, let's get in two or three circles. And as we, you know, just kind of prepare for the Lord's table and as we go into prayer, just share one thing that you're thankful for in 2022, you know, and, you know, one prayer need you have rolling into 2023. So just do that. And I'll give you a few minutes to just connect. So circle up. Feel free to get out from beside the aisles. Terry, don't do that. You just circle up. Am I live here? It didn't sound like it. Check one, two, check one, two. Check one, two. Hey, as you wrap up prayer together, I'm just going to join you here from the platform. Lord, it is wonderful to, on this Sunday, this January 1st, to be on the threshold of a new year. And for, Lord, all the things that we've experienced in 2022, tremendous blessings, tremendous burdens, things that have brought us great joy, things that have brought us great sadness. Lord, we recognize that in them all, you are at work. And as you direct us in 1 Thessalonians 5:18, Lord, you call us to give thanks to you in all circumstances.
for it is your will for us in Christ Jesus. Boy, how wonderful it is to know that you are at work in profound and mysterious ways through the good times and the challenging times. And we've all lived long enough to, Lord, to look back over, over years of walking with you and experience that oftentimes the toughest times return the greatest blessing over time. We don't understand that. That's a tremendous mystery. But we do recognize it because you are at work in us and through us to reveal the fullness of your glory. And Lord, as we look towards 2023, Lord, a new year, in a lot of ways, it's kind of arbitrary that it, how the calendar is set up. But what an opportunity to pause a moment and to look forward and to know that as you have been with us in the past, so you will be with us into the future to do grand and glorious things. Lord, so these cares and concerns, these blessings that we've shared together, Lord, we know that you hear us because you're always present and your ear is always, Lord, attuned to our hearts, both the joys and the sorrows. And Lord, and so we give you great thanks. And especially, Lord, as we prepare to receive your supper this morning on this first day in January, first day in 2023. Lord, move deeply in our hearts that, Lord, that it might be truly an act of renewal, of recommitment to you. Lord, we know you hear us, for we pray the prayer you taught us to pray when you said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen." Boy, and as you return to your seats, we'll be taking up the offering, Tony, in just a second. But first, let's receive the body and blood of our Lord. And so on the night our Lord was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. As often as you eat of it, remember me." And then when the meal was over, he took the cup and he blessed it. And he said, "This is my blood, the blood of a new and everlasting covenant I'm making with you and with all people for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of it, remember me." The Lord invites all those who truly desire to be in fellowship with God and neighbor to feast together in his presence on his body and his blood. Tony and Terry, if you'll come. Thank you, Terry. This is the body of the Lord that has been broken for you. A And this is the blood of our Lord that has been shed for forgiveness of our sins and the sins of the whole world. Drink with thanksgiving in your heart. And let's continue our worship as we return to God as tithes and offerings as we sing hymn number 5, Come Thou Almighty King, which happens to be one of my top 10 of all time hymns. Come Thou Almighty King.
Come Thou Almighty King, help us Thy name to sing, help us to praise, Father all glorious, o'er all victorious, come and reign over us, Ancient of Days. Come Thou incarnate Word, gird on Thy mighty sword, our prayers attend, come and Thy people bless, and give Thy word success. Spirit of holiness on us descend. Come, Holy Comforter, Thy sacred witness bear. In this glad hour, Thou who almighty art, Thou rule in every heart, and ne'er from us depart, Spirit of power. To Thee, great One in Three, eternal praises be, hence evermore, Thy sovereign majesty, may we in glory see, and to eternity love and adore. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Lord, use these tithes and offerings just to reveal the splendor of Your presence in our lives and throughout the world. Amen.
Amen.
Hey, turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 3 on this final Sunday in Christmas, in the Christmas season. There we go. All right. Beginning in clarity, intended in two directions. Number one, remember, the Gospel of Luke is organized, I'll put it that way, in four distinct movements. The first movement is clarity, which begins with, you know, from Luke 1 with Jesus's birth, through to chapter 4, where Jesus begins His public ministry in Galilee, and then that moves to when He hits the road to head towards Jerusalem around the end of chapter 9, to the end of the gospel, where Jesus enters in Jerusalem for the last week of His life. Those four movements I've titled Clarity, because very clear who the Lord is and what he's up to. The second movement is confusion, and we'll see how Luke introduces that next week. I mean, it's just dramatic in the intent of confusion in Galilee. And then call and conflict as Jesus hits the road. And finally, crisis and climax with Jesus, of course, death and resurrection. Those four movements. And so beginning in clarity in that first movement, but also important for us to be clear at the beginning of a new year, for us to have real clarity about the nature of the gospel and what the Lord is up to in their lives. British philosopher Alistair MacIntyre said this: I can only answer the question, what am I to do, if I can answer the prior question of what story or stories do I find myself a part of? Okay? I can only know what to do if I'm in touch with what story I'm living. First Sunday of the new year, time for resolutions. What shall we do? Real important for us to dial in on the essential story that we're part of as we give our lives to Jesus. In a world of all kinds of competing stories, which essentially war against one another, bringing all kinds of chaos into the world. Luke 3, 1 through 6, as John the Baptist begins his public ministry with tremendous clarity. Follow along as I read. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being governor of Judea, and Herod being tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip, tetrarch of the regions of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Licinius, tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. And he went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall become straight, and the rough places shall become level ways, and all flesh shall see the salvation of our God. As we head towards clarity, as we seek to ground ourselves in clarity, both, remember, two dimensions, as the gospel is starting with clarity in Luke, in this first movement of the Gospel of Luke, but also for us to have clarity about the nature of the gospel, three movements that we're walking through in the world, in the real world, as the gospel narrative, as it, you know, takes root in the real world, in the call that the John the Baptist gives us to repent for the forgiveness of sins, and then in the wonder of salvation. So let's start in the real world, okay? Of all the Gospels, Luke, remember, as he begins the Gospel, he's giving an orderly account. And, I mean, look at this order. I mean, look at the detail that Luke gives us. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being governor of Judea, Herod being tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip, tetrarch of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Licinius, tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Ananias and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness, and he went into the region around the Jordan. So let me ask the question, when did all this begin? Well, in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate, did you get Luke's point here? He is nailing the gospel story, the gospel narrative in the history of the real world, not an empty mythological stories. Alistair MacIntyre's quote, his statement that if for us to know what we need to do, we need to know what story we're living in. is to appreciate the power of mythology, the stories we tell. And back when Jesus entered the world, there were all kinds of mythological stories that were informing what the world was all about. The most compelling story was the divine Caesar, Caesar Augustus, who was the first Caesar of the Roman Empire. Declared himself to be son of a god because Julius Caesar, his adopted father, was deified by the Senate. And in the eastern part of the Roman Empire, which, you know, Israel was a part of, Judea was a part of, they took that very, very seriously. And so all the major cities, there were temples to Augustus Caesar, son of God. And it was that story that was told that kind of facilitated Roman control of its empire. They understood that if they can get the common folks to really believe this story, that Augustus Caesar is the son of God, the Prince of Peace, who brings peace into the world. Well, that's, you know, most of the work is done. Yes? Right? Myth. It's an empty story. Luke grounds the beginning of Jesus' ministry with John the Baptist, not in an empty talk, but in the real world. And it's just as important for us today as it was back then, because all kinds of stories are driving American culture. And if we're not careful, they'll be driving us. So Kathleen told us we needed to watch on HBO, The Vow, okay? Don't recommend it if you're offended by F-bombs. There are F-bombs all over the place. But it's a documentary on Keith Raniere, who was called Vanguard. He had an organization he led. He was the spiritual guru of a business, really, called Nexium. And their primary work was the ESP was what they offered, executive success programs. Invite rich, beautiful, successful people for 5 days intensives to draw them into a self-help process which would make them even more successful and more beautiful. Living the story of the American dream, that's what success is all about. And the more refined, the better I can become in my executive functioning, you know, the more successful I will be, okay? Out of that community, hold together this group of women called DOS, which is Latin, Dominus Obsequious Sororium. Okay? What does that mean? Well, Master of the Obedient Female Companions. Okay? Or, another way to translate it, Master over Slave Women. This hit hard. You may have remembered about 4 years ago, about 2017 is when the feds jumped into this because one mother, Catherine Oxenberg's daughter, India, was caught up into this dynamic, into this cult by this genius narcissist, Keith Raniere, who had cultivated essentially a number of concubines for his sexual gratification. And Mother Catherine worked endlessly with others who had left the organization earlier to get the feds involved. And this clip, Chad or Zane aren't there. I hope they got this video ready. Well, I know that's there. I'm going to make sure the volume's up. Chad, can you hear me? Zane? Okay, are you ready? Computer, volume, that's it, hits. Let me back up. What Keith Raniere had these women do is take a brand, like a cattle brand, okay? Right about here, marking them as his possessions, okay? And that's how this brief clip is going to start. Okay, here we go.
Tell me about the night you were branded.
It was horrible. At the time, I thought I was doing this empowering bonding moment with a group of friends that I considered my nearest and dearest.
And you had no idea that it was Keith's initials. I remember right. that.
I mean, yeah. That's the real thing, is that we were told that it was a symbol of the elements and that this was going to be a bonding experience. We were starved. Yeah. We were coerced. You don't just decide to be branded. You're coerced into being branded.
For years, Catherine fought publicly and behind the scenes to free India from the group.
Did you always believe, Catherine, that this day would come, or did you fear that it wouldn't?
God, I lived in fear for probably 2 years, but my faith has always been stronger than my fear, always.
What do you want everyone to take away from your story?
Well, you don't have to be in a cult to be coerced.
I don't know anybody on the planet who hasn't been manipulated
or fooled
or exploited or fooled in some way, or has been in a controlling, abusive relationship. There's predation on so many different levels.
We all have metaphorical scars. I have a physical scar, but you don't have to live with that. You don't have to live with Keith Raniere haunting you. You can reclaim your life. You can learn from it, and you can move on. And you can heal and you can have love, and I just feel so lucky.
Could you hear that okay? Right? At the end there, Catherine was saying, you don't have to be in a cult to be fooled, to be manipulated. The reason that is because we are living in a time desperate for a true story, a true narrative to live from. And so rich, successful people with a desperately hollow core get sucked into, the story of success, self-help. I can be better. I can be more successful. Yes? I mean, there are other stories. This at the news this week. Man receives nearly 20 years in prison for plot to kidnap Governor Gretchen Whitmer. Remember that a couple years ago? The folks who got arrested when they were, in the midst of that political turmoil, trying to kidnap Governor Whitmer. Barry Croft planned to use guns and explosives to abduct Michigan's governors, prosecutors said. He was the final, He was the final federal defendant to face sentencing. In court on Wednesday, Nils Kessler, a federal prosecutor, told a judge that Mr. Croft provided the ideological impetus for the plot and that his conduct was similar in many ways to the actions of foreign terrorists, okay? This is why I'm sharing this. He's the spiritual leader of this group, this movement, the same way that some sheikh in ISIS might be, Mr. Kessler said. Later, he added, what ISIS or Al-Qaeda calls a mujahideen, he calls a patriot. See that? What was driving that political craziness of January 6th and all the rest of it was a narrative, a story that gripped a significant portion of our culture, driven by that QAnon craziness and other elements that saying, man, this is what's happening. And they give themselves, and that's, this guy who got 20 years for trying to kidnap the governor, right, was the guru. was the sheik of these folks who were giving themselves to this false story. Everyone see that? Okay, it's everywhere, all right? Just as real in our day as it was in Jesus' day. So as John begins, as Luke begins his gospel, he doesn't begin with empty talk, you know, weaving a story to, you know, to captivate us. It's a specific time, specific place, specific people. Jesus came in the real world. This is not a false myth. True events, true story. Yes? Okay. And Luke is laboring to make this very, very clear. Okay. So let's get clarity on the call. And this is important. There in verse 3, and he went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. Okay, repentance for the forgiveness of sins. John is living in the midst of an ongoing story. What God began to do didn't begin with Jesus. It began with Abraham, right? And went through Moses. And all that Old Testament is laying out a story that Jesus enters into, that Jesus comes to fulfill. And when we give our lives to Jesus, he invites us to enter into that story as well. One of the key texts in the Old Testament that everybody needs to know, I mean, there are a number of key texts. Romans 12, 1, 2, and 3, God's call to Abraham. You know, go from this place, and I'll make of you a great nation, and through you all the families of the earth will be blessed. Critical verse to be anchored into. Exodus 19, where God meets with Moses and the people after God got the people out of Egypt on Mount Sinai, where God says, if you hear my voice and keep my covenant, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation, which gives us not only Israel's purpose, but our purpose. And then we come to Deuteronomy 30, verses 1 through 3. And when all these things, this is Moses, and when all these things come upon you, the blessings and the curse, which I have set before you, when you call them to mind among all the nations where the Lord God has driven you, and you return to the Lord your God, you and your children. Repentance. When you return to the Lord your God. And we need clarity about this. Because repentance is not about feeling bad about the bad things I've done and making a New Year's resolution never, ever, ever to do it again. That's not what repentance is all about. That's deeply in our church thinking, in American church culture. I'm just going to tell you, good luck trying to live that agenda. That's not what repentance is all about. We are unable. We do not have the ability, the power to untangle the sin. You know, that grips us. You want to try? Try. Let me know when you get sick and tired of being sick and tired, right? Right? What's repentance all about? Man, when you experience the curse of living a life without God central and active in your life, return to God. Turn towards him. Repent. Okay. Am I clear? It's not stop doing the bad things you're doing. Foundationally, it's turn to the Lord. Because we're powerless. And we're a mess. And we're confused. Well, repent's the verb, repentance is the noun, right? So repent is the action of turning towards God. Repentance just labels that. That's what that is, okay? Now, So it begins there, right? Repent. Okay. Turn Godward. Okay. And as John the Baptist began his ministry in the wilderness, do you see him speaking out of, let me back up, speaking out of this deep story? Moses is saying, hey, you guys are going to get caught up. We are so profoundly broken. When you find yourself in a world of hurt, here's the promise. If you return to the Lord our God, you see? John the Baptist is speaking right into that story. And all the Jews who are listening to John the Baptist in the wilderness, what they're thinking, wow, it's happening now. Here's this wild man coming out of the wilderness, sounding like the prophets of old, and he seems to be saying that what Moses promised in Deuteronomy 30 is about to unfold. Return to the Lord your God. Repent. Are you with me here? Okay. For the forgiveness of sins. Now, what we have in our head is, this is a get out of jail free card, right? Forgiveness of sins means because of Jesus, God looks at me and declares not guilty, so I get out of jail. I get out of hell, and everything's good. Because my sins have been forgiven, I'm saved. Okay? Have you heard that story? Okay? Kind of, right? That's the kind of story. What in the world does John the Baptist mean by repentance for the forgiveness of sins? Right? Return to the Lord your God, you and your children, and we saw this last week, and obey his voice. And Irene, what's that word? Shema, right? Hear his voice. Hear his voice. See, what forgiveness of sins is all about is the Lord forgives us so that he can be in our lives. See? Not so we get out of hell, so that we become open to his presence. He forgives us so he can indwell us, so we can hear his voice. What's so important about hearing his voice? It's only in hearing his voice that he begins to untangle the mess we're in. We're not smart enough to do that. We can't figure it out. We don't know how tangled up and confused and, you know, all the trauma that throws us into the self-medication and the craziness and all of that, which is why repentance is not stop doing it, because we're so tangled up and confused and wound up, we'll never untangle ourselves. Man, but we start hearing his voice, because he knows. He knows where the hurts are. He knows where the trauma is. He knows where the confusion is. He knows what we need to understand that we don't understand. He knows what false story we're living and what new story he wants us to be drawn into. And as we learn to hear his voice, are you with me here? Know what the Bible word for that is? You guys know what the Bible word for that is? What is it? Well, yeah, kind of the gospel. There's a better word. There's a bigger word. Salvation. That's what salvation is. See? We're used to thinking about salvation as getting out of hell when we die. Huh? Salvation is getting out of hell while we live. You with me? If you're waiting to get out of hell when you die, you don't have clarity. You don't understand what it's all about. See? Okay, so look at this. So John comes quoting Isaiah 40. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, and that's himself, that's John the Baptist. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight.
Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall become straight, and the rough places shall become level ways. And look at verse 6. And all flesh shall see the salvation of God. Now, let me tell you, if salvation is about getting out of hell when you die, how in the world is all flesh seeing that? They're not seeing where we end up when we die. What in the world is he taught? What in the world is first Isaiah and now John the Baptist quoting the ancient story? What's he talking about? He's talking about a full restoration here and now. See? And he's preparing the way for Jesus, the King, who comes to restore all things and to begin to show the reality of salvation at work in the world, because sins have been forgiven and God is now present in the person of Jesus. And when he dies and ascends to heaven, raises from the dead and ascends to heaven, he fills, sends the Holy Spirit. Because God is present among us to do stuff in us and through us here and now. Well, what kind of stuff? Are you ready for this? Everything Jesus did. The kind of stuff that Jesus did. I mean, the nations are welcomed. And that's what we're going to see next week as Jesus goes into the synagogue in Galilee and confuses profoundly the folks of his hometown, because Jesus proclaims the gospel of the kingdom of God that welcomes not just the Jews, but everybody. And we'll see you next week that they get so angry out of their confusion that they want to throw Jesus off a cliff. But all the nations are welcome. The lame are healed. And so we see Jesus healing people all over the place. The guilty are forgiven. The outcasts are restored. The hungry are fed. Worldly power is rejected. Sacrificial service is modeled on the cross. Atonement is made in Jesus' death. And the reality of resurrection is validated when Jesus rose from the dead. And let me tell you, everybody then living saw it, right? All flesh saw the salvation of God in the person of Jesus, changing everything, restoring everything. Yes? And that, gang, is the story we're a part of. So as we think about, boy, what is going to happen in 2023? What am I to do? What does the Lord want me to do? As you prayerfully think through that, and we all need to, we got to be sure we're in the right story. Right? It's not to become the best you can possibly be. That's Keith Raniere's story. That opens us to all kinds of manipulation. Right? It's not a restored, you know, political America. Right? That's the Patriots' narrative. We're living a very different story where Jesus has come to restore all things in us and through us for his glory. That's the story. Will you bow your hearts and heads with me? Lord God, it's a tremendous, tremendous reality, Lord, to know that you came into the real world, Lord, that it's not just a story we tell, but you came in a specific place at a specific time to live faithfully among us. God in the flesh, the faithful Messiah, fulfilling Israel's role, calling the whole world, calling us to turn towards you, to hear your voice, that our confusion might be entangled, that we might be truly, truly equipped to live for your glory, to manifest the wonder of your salvation. Oh, Lord, at the beginning of 2023, Lord, as we deeply ponder these things, Lord, as we spend time with you, Lord, draw us more deeply into the clarity of your story. Lord, and move among us that we might live in that story for your glory. We ask it in your wonderful, precious name. Amen.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross and lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Slain. Worthy is the King that conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Worthy is the King that conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Worthy is the King that conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Worthy. Worthy, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. And lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
So on the threshold of 2023, go from this place filled with his presence, filled with his power, and serve him for his glory, both now and forever. Amen.
This is amazing grace.